on Main Street, Sex and the American Teenager, Teen Mothers and Fathers, Non-Sexual Relationships, Sex Education, Mixed-Up Messages from the Media, and Dr. Ruth Westheimer in person on Main Street.
Good afternoon. I'm Bryant Gumbel. My pleasure to welcome you to Main Street, our NBC News program that's designed especially for you. Though this is the sixth time my Main Street friends and I have gathered here, it is the first time that we intend to spend our entire allotted time dealing with one subject. That subject, my buddies, is sex. Three-letter word, four-letter impact. And I'm sure some of you are uncomfortable with the story. Now, why is that? Why is it the mere mention of the word makes some people uneasy? Tell me.
It's kind of like it's such a controversial subject, and
it's personal.
People don't talk about it that often.
It's personal?
Mm-hmm.
So you don't want to talk about it?
Well, not if you want to talk about it, but
it's embarrassing.
Well, it can be embarrassing talking to friends and maybe even sometimes parents.
Quick show of hands. How many of you have talked about sex with your parents? Not bad. Not bad. Everybody here. How many of you had sex education courses in school? Near unanimous. We're going to touch on both areas of that as we progress through this program. Let's do a couple of things up front. For the next hour, we are not going to run a sex education class, nor are we going to try to say what's right or what's wrong. Instead, we intend to talk about today's attitudes towards sex and some of the problems young people are having dealing with sex. Let's start with some incredible numbers. This year, more than 1 million girls under the age of 19 will become pregnant, and about half of them will have babies. More than 250,000 of them will be born out of wedlock. What's life like for a single teenage girl who suddenly becomes a mother? Well, let's call in our Bill Schechner and ask him. Bill went to Georgia and to Minnesota to observe the lifestyles of two very different teenagers sharing common problems. They're not married, and they are trying to raise their babies. Bill, what did you find?
Well, Brian, I found out above everything else, it's real hard. The amount of money that the family earns makes a real big difference. But beyond everything, raising a baby means dealing with adult responsibilities in a big hurry. And that's what this story is about.
People say, well, it could be too hard. It's just like babysitting. Well, it's not like babysitting because they're kids with you all the time.
15-year-old Shelley Preston lives in Chaska, Minnesota, a small town 30 miles from Minneapolis. She became pregnant with her son Matthew when she was 13.
Were you using birth control when you became pregnant?
No.
How come?
Because I didn't have the knowledge of it. I mean, it was not spoken about. It wasn't on TV. They did not talk about it in school. You didn't have the knowledge of it.
Were you aware that what you were doing sexually could create a baby?
Oh, yeah, I was aware. But, you know, that one time, you don't think, you know, one simple time, that's it, you know.
First time?
Yeah.
Mom?
Yeah.
Shelley no longer has a close relationship with Matthew's father, but he visits his son on weekends.
Let's go, come on.
Each year, about 135,000 white teenagers like Shelley have babies. Once, they would have been forced to marry or give up their babies. Times have changed. Like more and more white teenagers, Shelley decided to keep her child. And that has forced her to face the pressure of being a teenage mother.
Teenage years are supposed to be carefree, right?
Yeah, that's what they say.
How about yours?
Huh? No. No, definitely not.
What do you worry about?
Well, I worry about Matthew. I worry about my grades. I worry about where the money's going to come from. I worry about tons of things.
Shelley got more than the usual support from her parents. Her father is the product of a broken home, her mother, a teen mother herself. They decided immediately to give Shelley whatever help they could.
Main thing is I love my daughter. My mom didn't throw me out of the house. Why should I throw her out?
I guess you gotta call it kind of a bargain. We help raise a baby, she stays in school.
Shelley's mother watches Matthew while Shelley is in school. That helps. Shelley's marks are good. But even though she's away from her son, she can't act like an impulsive teenager.
So many friends say, well, let's just go skip a class, you know. I can't do that. I want to get good grades. I want to make sure I want to go into college. I want to, you know, I want to make something in my life so I can make make Matthew's life better.
This is a new school for Shelley. She came here to get a fresh start. When Shelley became pregnant, she got a reputation. There was vicious gossip and whispered talk among some students. Dealing with that has been one of the hardest parts of being a teenage mother.
It hurt at first. All of a sudden, they backed away and didn't, you know, well, don't be around her, you know, like I had some kind of disease or something.
They assume you're a bad girl?
Yeah.
What kind of things have happened that make you know that?
Oh, I've seen guys come up to me and they know that I have a kid and they ask me out just for that one reason and sorry, no.
Did it ever hurt you?
Hurt me in what way? That guys thought of me that way? Yeah.
Tell me a little bit why it hurt you.
Well, to have guys only ask you for one reason, that, you know, that hurts you quite a bit just alone.
Have you had to be tough? Have you had to learn how to sort of strengthen yourself?
Before, I was so afraid of saying no to my friends, you know, like, no, I can't pick you up tonight, or no, I can't go out with you, or I wanted to be nice to everybody, to make everybody happy. Well, now, forget it.
You're not a kid anymore.
No.
What are you?
You can't really say adult because, you know, you still have those teen things that you have to do. And so you're just caught in between. You're a teenager with adult responsibilities.
I got pregnant because I didn't think my mother noticed me or anything.
How would having a baby change that?
Because then I would be getting attention. And after I had the baby, they would come and see me, and then they would give me things and get a baby things, and they would notice me a little bit more.
Atlanta, Georgia, the inner city. Chris Sanders in church with her mother and her daughter, Camille. Chris became pregnant at 14. It is a hard world for Chris. She no longer has any tie to Camille's father. And she finds strength and love in two places, in church and with Camille.
No one can come between us because she's going to love me no matter what, and I'm going to love her. If somebody tells me to stop loving her, I look at them like they're crazy and ask them what planet they're from. Because love of everything, love is the bond of everything.
Chris's day begins before dawn. There is no one to help. Her mother is off to her own job as a house cleaner.
There'll be some mornings I wake up and I say, well, I'm just going to give up. And then you always have that little mind, that little voice in the back saying, go, go. So I get up and go because I have to do it.
Wait a minute. Wait.
Because her mother cannot watch Camille, Chris must take her baby to a babysitter. The only one she trusts and can afford is an hour and a half round trip away. Chris makes that trip twice a day. Births to black teenagers are at a crisis level. The rate is 7 times that for whites. Almost all the babies are kept by their mothers. 90% of the mothers aren't married, are poor, are struggling.
Did you know about birth control?
In some sense, I just knew birth control. That's all. The different methods I didn't know about. How to get it, I didn't know about.
Writing many articles and essays.
Chris missed 6 months of school when Camille was born. She goes to an alternative school, but the pressure of being a mother has turned her B-plus average to a C-minus.
I feel bad, and I tell myself I got to do better if I expect to get out of high school.
Do you think you will?
Mm-hmm.
Lots of teenage mothers don't.
Maybe they don't have what I have.
What's that?
Determination.
But even determination isn't always enough.
Sometimes I want to be petty and act my age. I don't have time to sit down and read a book or sit down and stargaze or sit down and listen to the radio in peace, things like that.
Chris's mother supports the family. She brings home about $100 a week. After food, rent, daycare, and utilities are paid for, there is almost nothing left.
We get hard, because a lot of things I want, a lot of things my mom want me to have, I can't have because of Tamia, and she needs things. I have to say to myself, you know, it's her. It's just, you know, it's going to have to be for her, and you're just going to have to wait. Because she's your responsibility. That's what it's all about.
Being a teenage parent runs in your family, though.
It's a history. It's like something that's going down now. Because my mother had my brother when she was young, and then I turned around and had Camille. And I hope that doesn't happen to her. I don't want it to be a tradition. I want it to be non-tradition. I want it to stop with me.
Do you think it will?
I don't know. It's
almost easy.
Before they became pregnant, neither Chris nor Shelley thought about raising children. They love them now that they're here, but both say they should have waited. Teenage motherhood is too much, too soon.
I would have waited until I got through with college.
Why?
Because then it would have been a little bit more stabler for Matthew. You know, I would have been done with my schooling, I would have had a job, I would have, you know, had our own home. But now it's not like that. You know, first now I got him, now I have to get school done, now I have to get the job. You know, it's just totally backwards.
I didn't have to keep this baby. I could have gave it up for adoption, and I could have had an abortion, but I didn't, and I kept her. So I kept her for a reason.
What was that reason?
Because I loved her before she even got here.
That love requires a big sacrifice, doesn't it?
Big sacrifice. Almost half of your life. Let's say the majority of your life.
Sounds tough.
Yeah, but it is tough. It's a lot to have to think about when you're 15.
Bill, we heard Chris talking about she decided to keep her baby after choosing not to exercise other options. The numbers suggest that an awful lot of girls do choose the other options. What's the trend?
About 40% of the unwed teenage girls who become pregnant have an abortion. But that means that more than half keep their baby. There's very little adoption these days. Very, very little.
What'd you think as you sat there watching them, Lee?
Extremely frightening. I mean, Shelley said she got pregnant at 13. I'm 13 now. I mean, you think about it.
Well, it's got to be scary, though, because, like, I mean, we're all sitting here, and all the girls could be pregnant, and all the guys could be fathers, from what we've just seen. I mean, it's not true.
I understand what you're saying.
Yeah, and it's like, thinking about it, it's just like a whole new concept, because you're not ready for it.
I really feel sorry for them. They really miss out a whole lot on life.
In a sense, that's the price that they pay for doing what they did.
Oh, wait a minute. What is this? She had it coming to her?
No, well, I'm not saying that, well, punish her. She should have a baby for doing what she did, but I'm not saying that. You know, I don't believe that.
Yeah, but I think the worst part...
I mean, there's not necessarily anything wrong with having sex. It's different, you know, but I think people should take precautions to keep from having children when they're too young, but I don't think there's anything wrong with having sex.
How many of you who are watching it found it hard to believe and had to keep on saying, hey, they're my age?
Yes. Yeah.
Ooh. Bill, thank you.
You're welcome.
Real good start. After a couple of commercial breaks, we're going to hear from a couple of high school students who are going steady right now, and we'll see how they're dealing with sex. But first, a change of pace. Those of you who've been with us before know that on the commercial break, we always enjoy a little music here. Today, as we head for our commercials, we're going to check out the Oscar nominees for Best Original Song in a Movie. First up, from the movie The Color Purple, is Miss Seeley's Blues. We'll be back.
Have I got news for you? I'm something. I hope you think that you're something too.
Main Street, brought to you in part by Kellogg's Frosted Mini Wheats.
I love the rich, whole wheat goodness of Kellogg's Mini Wheats. But the delicious frosted side makes the rich kid in me open wide.
The nutritious shredded wheat helps keep me on my toes. But the little ballerina in me thinks the taste steals the show.
Kellogg's Mini Wheats, wholesome shredded wheat for the adult in you, great taste for the kid in you, so they're delicious and nutritious.
The whole grain wheat really packs a crunch, but the delicious taste gives it just the right punch.
Tracker here, assemble mask.
When venom strikes, there's only one team to call, mask.
where illusion is the ultimate weapon.
Get in the way, Hondo!
Fire, Quacker, confirm!
Too late, McClane!
Fire!
Vehicles each sold separately with a figure.
You'll never catch the vampire. We'll see. Firefly, convert.
Mask, where illusion is the ultimate weapon. Mask, firecracker, vampire, and firefly. Each sold separately, new from Kenner.
Alberto says,
go for style with my European styling gel.
Shape and sculpt your hair with Alberto's new hair sculpture line. Contour, curve, form, and fashion.
Alberto Hair Sculpture. When the work of art is you.
New VO5 hairspray is actually good for my hair. It doesn't leave it dry. It truly improves my hair's condition. Doesn't dull or damage. And the more I use it, the better my hair looks and feels.
Patented VO5. Good for your hair.
Yoo-hoo, doggie.
Yeah, that's right. Where those crazy Swedish chefs here to put a smorgasbord in your bowl?
Mitt, that's smorgasburger!
First we chop the cheese and chicken.
Next we grind the beef and liver.
Then we mix it all together. Now you got the smorgasburger, smorgasburger. Yeah, that is the smorgasburger. Chicken, cheese, beef and liver. Yeah, that is the smorgasburger.
Smorgasburger from Kettle Ration. It's like a smorgasbord in a bowl.
We're back now on Main Street, where this day we are talking about sex in the American teenager. You know, experts say about half the young women in the United States and more than half the young men between the ages of 15 and 19 have had sexual intercourse. That means that roughly half of the teenagers in the United States have not had sexual intercourse yet. What about them? Well, out in the suburbs of Seattle, Washington, there is 17-year-old Lisa Lindsay, who's been going steady with 18-year-old Jason Boole for about 7 months now. There are a couple of high school seniors who have made some choices, and we're willing to talk about them.
My boyfriend's name is Jason, and we're both seniors in high school. We met dancing 7 months ago, and we've been going steady ever since. Jason's a really fun person to be with. He's kind of off the wall sometimes, and I'm never bored around him. I really like Jason. I think it approaches love in a lot of ways, because I care about him a lot. I think about him all the time.
We both want someone that we can talk to, and someone that we can hold on to and feel cared for.
I see Jason on the weekends because we can spend a lot of time with each other. We sometimes go down to the beach near his house and just walk around there, and that's really nice. Doing that gives me a really calm feeling, just really, really secure. A relationship definitely comes first for me before sex, because it's a real emotional thing and I wouldn't want to set myself up to get hurt. I'd be dumb, you know? To rush into something like that, it's just not a good idea.
We could have sexual intercourse right now if we wanted, but we just don't feel the need for it.
We want whipping cream, don't we? And fudge?
God.
What, did you want to share a spoon?
No.
Jason and I do have an understanding about having sex. If it doesn't happen, you know, it's no big deal, because there are other things that happen in our relationship that make it good. And in fact, I think it would hurt. It would harm it. I like where, you know, the decisions I've made, and a lot of my other friends have made the same decision, and, you know, they don't regret it.
The reason I didn't have sex is because I was always waiting for something to just overcome me that makes me have to do it. Nothing was ever right, all three. Like, my mind didn't say yes, my body didn't say yes, the person wasn't there. All that has to happen at the same time. And it's never been that way.
My reasons are just go the spectrum, the whole range. One of them's obviously the way I've grown up with my parents and their attitudes toward it. And also seeing a lot of my friends go through abortions and trauma like that.
Seeing all the pain and all the heartache that goes into it, being young and not prepared for it, just turned me off of it completely.
A lot of people are trying to experiment with sex when they're very young, just because
they right after they go through puberty, they're really no, not horny. No, they're really curious about sex, and they, I feel that a lot of people rush into it too soon just to find out what it's all about.
I've gotten more signs of respect for not having had sex than I have people going, "You haven't? What's wrong with you?"
Whether it's acceptable or unacceptable to anybody else doesn't really matter, because it's nobody else's business. It's your personal private life, and nobody else should even be involved in it at all. You know, it's whatever is right for you, I think.
I agree with Cheryl. It's a personal decision. You can't let anybody make up your mind for you. You know, society's rules, you just have to make up your own mind. And as for me and Jason, we're making those decisions in our relationship right now.
This feeling down deep in my soul that I just can't lose. Guess I'm on my way. Might be glad to stay.
Pretty pictures. Jason and Lisa kissing in the sunset. How lovely. Typical, square, unusual, Kendra?
No, I mean, it's like, I mean, it's, I think it's in some ways a dream. Like, people wouldn't mind. I mean, I think people look forward to it. Just seems having a nice, quiet time in the sunset on a beach.
But I think that a really important thing in a relationship is that the choice is made between the two people. It's a very personal thing. And, like, no one's really pressuring each other because they respect each other. And I think that's really important to get a good relationship and not, like, have sex as an award.
Now, what happens when those urgings, those longings come to the surface?
Then it happens.
Then it happens.
Yeah, I think you definitely have to have control over your feelings. You can't just let them.
You have to be sure that that's what you really want.
It's a mutual decision. If one person isn't ready, you can't have sex with them. Because it's a very emotional experience.
And if they're both ready and they're just going steady and they're teenagers, then?
Then if they're really ready and they're ready to accept the responsibilities of possibly becoming parents, and, you know, they've got birth control and everything, I guess if they want to.
To show a person that you love them, you don't have to have sex with them. It's not something...
But it's more fun. Like everybody's been saying, it's an agreement that you made.
But in
like
this relationship, you can be perfectly happy having sex. That shouldn't to be a factor in a relationship. You're really being pressured by the
other
person.
Somewhere between an arms treaty and the Magna Carta. Let's take a break. Okay? Remember earlier I asked how many of you had taken sex education classes. Well, in just a minute, a student reporter will join us with a look at what his school is doing to make sex education more effective. But first, as we head into a commercial, let's listen to another song that's been nominated for an Oscar. This one I think you've heard before. It's The Power of Love from the film Back to the Future. We'll come back to the present right after this.
Someone once said that hidden in every adult is a child that wants to play. You can go have a bite. You can hold on to that feeling with the natural nutrition in dairy foods, like cheese, yogurt, and milk. Just 3 servings give an adult a full day's calcium for strong, healthy bones, so you can always feel as young in body as you are at heart. Dairy foods, calcium the way nature intended.
These lonely Pound Puppies need someone to love. Someone who'd love a little puppy love.
For you, Grandma.
Pound Puppies are as cuddly as real puppies.
He'll keep you company in the dorm.
They're the perfect way to say, "I love you," for birthdays, holidays, or any day. Pound Puppies, so soft and adorably lonely. Sometimes the hardest thing about giving them...
Happy Valentine's Day.
...is giving them up.
Pound Puppy, you're my one and only puppy love.
Morris discovers 9 Lies Crunchy Meals.
Morris! Surprise!
Guess which hand.
I hate games.
Hint, it's a delicious dry cat food.
Dry? Game's over.
It's nine lives.
Nine lives? Well, I don't want to be a poor sport.
Mm. Nine Lives Crunchy Meals. Mars's favorite flavors, like Super Supper, made crunchy. At last, a crunchy cat food good enough for Morris.
Nine Lives Crunchy Meals. You're the only game in town.
Turn on the juice. Let it flow. Turn on the juice. Let it go. Orange juice for your body. Turn it on to keep it. Turn it on all you want. It's got a taste that won't quit. Turn it on. Turn on the juice.
America's turning on to 100% pure orange juice, which carries Florida's seal of approval. That means juice packed to standards even higher than the federal government.
Turn it on. Turn on the juice. Look for the seal.
We'll return to our discussion on sex on Main Street with some numbers again. Recent polls show that more than 75% of the American people favor sex education in the schools. Those who are still opposed to sex education claim you can't teach teenagers about sex without giving them the impression that you approve them having sex. Ron Omad is familiar with that complaint. Ron's a senior at Northeast High School in Kansas City, Missouri. His school just started sex education courses this year, and it's one of the very few high schools in the United States to get a privately operated health clinic in the school itself. Ron, how's the latest approach been greeted?
Well, first of all, most of the students I talked to said they would have preferred to have been taught about sex at home by their parents. As far as sex education in school, experts say that just having it in a school doesn't increase or decrease sexual activity much one way or the other. And then what is sex education really? What I found out is that it's much more than learning about the mechanics of sex or about birth control, but more about responsibility and good decision making. At my school, at least, that's what they mean when they talk about sex ed. This is where I go to school, Northeast High in Kansas City, Missouri. About 1,100 students, 50% white, 40% black, and 10% Hispanic and Asian. In Missouri public schools, sex education is an elective course if it's offered at all. My only sex ed was in junior high. I was 14. The course lasted a week or two and was taught as a part of my science class. It was very informal, more of a classroom discussion. I didn't learn too much, but it turns out it was a lot more information than most kids get. Sex education is new here at Northeast High. There were no formal sex ed classes here until this year. We also got a new health clinic I'll tell you about later. But what about before? I asked kids where they got their information before the sex ed classes started.
Streets.
Streets.
Streets. Yeah,
older guys or something.
People that's already been through it, maybe uncles and older cousins and people like that.
I mainly learn it from other adults.
It's easier to talk to a friend about it.
It's always been pretty easy to talk to my mother.
What about you, Shalee?
No, it was not real easy to talk to my mother about it. I think that's why I have Shalee.
Today, there is a teenage crisis in America.
Coach Harris is one of our gym teachers. He got sex education started as a part of the physical education course. He invited people from our new health clinic to talk to us about sex, not just the physical part. They talk a lot about responsibility, self-esteem, and decision-making.
I want to stress that there's a lot of emotional kinds of risk, too. If a young woman or a young man isn't ready to be sexually active, it can really cause some emotional feelings that aren't very good.
What does it mean to be a sexual human being? I mean, all of you are. You've been a sexual person from the time you were born. You're going to be a sexual person until the time you die. So what does that mean?
The level of information that teenagers are getting in terms of how their body's functioning, the real correct information, they're not receiving that any more than I received it when I was a teenager. And they're not getting supported in terms of how to make good decisions. You need to talk about how you feel about yourself. Self-esteem is very important. A person that has real good self-esteem isn't going to do anything that's going to hurt themselves.
It's like she said that just holding hands, you know, that shows your sexuality, and talking and kissing and hugging. You don't have to have sex to show your sexuality and stuff.
It taught me about how to use things and stuff, but it's not like I'm going to go out and do it. I mean, because I'm going to wait for a while because I'm not ready for it.
It'll make you think about, you know, next time would you have sex, you know,
what kind of precaution you should take.
You should be told earlier, you know, instead of waiting all the way to senior high.
Junior high. Because I know kids in junior high that have kids, and they're in ninth grade, you know.
They learn the street way, then you got babies coming in already, and then, you know, you don't want that.
This is the clinic. It's in the school, but it's privately operated. Doctors, nurses, counselors, and social workers provide general health care, something many students never get. They'll fix a sprained ankle, give you an eye test or a physical exam, and you can go there privately for advice about sex or drugs or depression or anything else that's troubling you. Teenagers have lots of problems. Sex is just one.
Check it out, everybody, for the MC3.
There are only 43 school-based health clinics in the United States, but 60 more are planned. The idea of combining a health clinic with a solid sex education course began in a few high schools in St. Paul, Minnesota, and in just 7 years, the birth rate in those high schools dropped by as much as 50%. What do Northeast High students think about sex education now? I asked some of them.
They need to have it in school all the time.
I think they should learn earlier.
They ought to have just, you know, like regular classes for the people who want to know how to prevent that from happening to them, boys and girls.
If parents are scared to teach it to themselves, let the schools teach it to them where it should be taught.
I think it's better to be open and upfront about it, because if you forbid your daughter or your son to have sex, they're going to do it just to rebel against you. And I think if you talk to them about it and inform them the consequences, the good parts about it, they can handle themselves better.
Ron, there was a great figure in that report, great statistic, cut by 50%.
As much as 50%.
Yeah. Is it in or out to take it?
It's, when I looked in at some of the discussions, it's a lot of giggling and a lot of embarrassment, but next year, I don't know.
Is there a lot of giggling in your sex education classes, too?
Yeah.
I had it for 4.5 weeks in seventh grade, and they didn't, basically what they talked about was, like, the body parts and how babies are made.
Yes.
Yeah.
They
don't really learn at home. Yeah.
What do you want to learn? What would be more worthwhile?
Well, I think the responsibilities and what might come of having sex at an early age.
So how to judge, how to be careful, how, you know, what to do if the situation comes up, what not to do, what to do if you get in trouble, who to talk to.
One of the problems in our school was our teacher. I mean, when your teacher is kind of like groaning and going, clearing her throat while she's teaching it to you, I think it would be better.
She's not going to be a little more explicit and blunt and stop playing around with it.
Yeah, I think it would be better to have a healthcare clinic like they have in Kansas City. That might be a little more looser.
Our teacher, I mean, she talks about it, and she's not embarrassed about it at all. And
she's like,
if the kids are embarrassed,
our teacher was.
Then she has a box, and you put questions in the box, you know, and don't even have to sign your name.
Rob, what are you hearing from the parents?
I think that's where the controversy comes in, is parents don't want someone else teaching their kids about sex, and I think that's the big problem. I think it should be taught at home myself.
Thank you. Good luck to you.
Thank
okay,
you.
Well done. We're going to take a break. When we come back, we are going to be joined by the good sex lady. I look at Kimmy because Kimmy's been doing her impression all along. You want to do your impression real quick?
No.
No, she'll get mad.
No, she won't. Dr. Ruth Westheimer is going to join us shortly, so if you have some questions, as I suspect you do, she can perhaps answer them. But before we leave for a commercial, let's check out another Oscar nominee, this one from the movie Chorus Line. It's Surprise, Surprise.
Wednesday on Highway to Heaven.
It's kidnapping.
Can Jonathan make a Russian premier grant a mother's last wish, or will he be caught red-handed? Then on Black's Magic, a plane lands with no passengers and no pilot.
Emptier than a gigolo's promises.
I wonder why.
And on St. Elsewhere, Donald takes a liking to the new intern.
Oh, smoothie.
Wednesday.
When you wish upon a Disney star, all your dreams come true. You can spin through the past to the good old days, or trip the light fantastic. Kick up your heels in a Broadway show, or thrill to the skating of Olympic champion Linda Frodiani. A pageant of music and magical moments unfolds before your eyes in a carousel of color. Walt Disney's Magic Kingdom on Ice.
Celebrate 50 years of Twin Cities' own Ice Valleys, March 19th through 30th at Met Center. Tickets at box office and Dayton's.
It came without warning.
Best Buy Company proudly presents Video Mania, our biggest 4-day video sale ever. Video Mania features command performances from Panasonic, RCA, Zenith, Quasar, Mitsubishi, Fisher, and Sony. The critics are raving about Video Mania. Find out why in this special section in your Wednesday paper. Then hurry to Video Mania, now appearing at a Best Buy Company superstore near you.
Kirsten Lindquist, weeknights on News 11.
We're back now on Main Street, where it is our great pleasure to be joined by Dr. Ruth Westheimer.
Thank you, Brian.
A noted television host, radio host, author, and a lady who has given birth to a world of impressions, correct?
Correct.
Go ahead, Tammy, come on.
Tammy, even my kids do it. Okay. Let me hear.
Sex under pressure is bad sex. If you're relaxed, it's good sex.
Look at the great shade of red we get out of her. It's wonderful. I love it. Dr. Ruth, what should your tremendous success tell us about sexual attitudes in America?
Okay. I tell you something, Brian. What we do know is that people are very interested in sexuality, and that's as it ought to be. Mm. That doesn't mean doing it. Doing it is a different issue.
Sure.
But to be talking about it in the context like you do, Bryant, with them, is absolutely magnificent. I know that it has to be all of us together. Parents, it has to be the schools, mm-hmm. it has to be the television and the radio, and it has to be the churches and the synagogues. All of us together, the community centers, have to be able to sit around, talk about issues of concern and of sexuality. And I'm going to tell you in one moment, there was one term that none of you have mentioned yet today, and Brian has to guess it, but I'll wait a while. Let me hear first questions
in
from you.
In a society of such awareness
yes.
about social diseases and things that can happen
yes.
from having sex, how do you account for all the teenage pregnancies?
Because we have to stand up and say, hold it, wait. That's exactly what I said to my daughter, to my son. I'm saying, learn all there is to be talked about and taught about, but then make that decision, which I heard how you discussed it. Make that decision when it sits right inside you.
There is no ideal time then.
That's right. But there isn't, in my way, I'm rather an old-fashioned mother and a square, and I'm saying, wait, what's the rush? You're going to be sexually active, Brian, and all of you until the age of 99, correct?
That's encouraging.
Correct. What is the rush? That doesn't mean that you shouldn't be liking somebody, maybe even holding hands, but in order to really engage in sexual activity, wait a while. On the other hand, I do say, let's say a 17-year-old, if he and she say, we are going to be sexually active, I say, that we as a society must make contraceptives available rather than to have this catastrophe of these unwanted pregnancies. But we, Bryant, you and me, we are a hypocrite society. We are not honest. It's our fault.
The adults.
Not theirs. Right. Because we make believe as if a young person asks a question, right away that means, aha, they're going to do it.
Mm-hmm.
And then some mothers say, curfew. And they say to a girl, curfew from 7 o'clock in the evening. And you know what happens? People can get pregnant between 3 and 7 in the afternoon. Instead of us saying, let's hear some of your concerns.
I wanted to know, what do you think about sex ed in schools? And
I do believe that we must educate. Now, I heard you say, somebody said on your program about a teacher who couldn't say the words. She got all red.
Uh-huh.
You said
yeah.
She got all red and flustered. That person should first learn how to teach it. That's what I did for many years, teaching teachers how to teach it. Because if she's so embarrassed, she should take one of the things that you mentioned is the shoebox. Great. Put questions in the shoebox.
Put questions in there, no names.
Out. And you know what? It shouldn't just be the gym teacher. Just because the gym teacher knows about big muscles doesn't mean that they know about the sensitivity that is needed in talking and teaching about sex.
What do you say to people who call up and say that they don't like having sex with other people? They think, like, so, say, Are you talking about masturbation?
Yes.
And they called up and
everybody
said...
Everybody in a pros of hands. Because
that was the one area we
hadn't
touched on.
That nobody has touched on yet. Bravo!
And they called up and they said, you know, I think it's disgusting. I don't like it at all.
Right.
And it's
good
no good. What are you trying to tell those people?
I tell you what I'm saying. First of all, if I hear of a student who has time to gratify himself or herself to masturbate 4 hours each day, I get very worried because I say, hey, show me your grades. How come you have time to masturbate 4 or 5 hours each day? But you know, in our society, it's something to be done in the privacy. Not everybody does. Whoever doesn't do it, that's okay. Whoever does do it should not feel that they are doing something that will spoil their later sexual life. But I'm saying to them, don't be concerned. Don't think that hair grows in the palm of your hand or that your hair is going to fall
out. It's all hair. But you know what's funny? Everybody always shrinks away from that. Remember when you were in school and they say 90% of all boys masturbate? The other 10% were all the guys sitting around you. That's always. Never fails.
What do you feel is the moral issue behind sex? I mean, are there certain things that are right to do and certain things that are wrong to do?
Fabulous question. You're going to be a philosopher. No question.
Okay.
In my way of thinking, and some people don't agree with me, in my way of thinking, there's nothing wrong when two consenting, and now I'm going to say adults, because I have already made clear that it needs a certain maturity to be engaging in a sexual activity. Whatever they do, in my way of thinking, if you ask me what do I think is wrong, when violence is involved or when children are involved. So these two aspects I put aside. Anything else, when there are two people who really care for each other, really like each other, even if they do it on the kitchen floor, is all right.
On that note, I'm going to have to close it down, and we will come back and do that last thing. Sexually active till 99, huh?
Yes. Promise you.
I love you. Dr. Ruth, thank you.
Very much. Thank you.
In just a moment, we're going to look to the rather tough life of a teenage father, but first, another Oscar nominee. This one's one of two nominees from the movie White Nights. It's Separate Lives. We'll come back right after this. Thank you, though.
99. I can't go out, just holding on. Now that we're living second life.
I remember when we first met, me and my favorite pet.
Oh, they call it Fluffy Dogs.
Introducing the Fluffy Dogs collection.
She shook my hand when I shook her paw. There was a spark we couldn't ignore.
Oh, they call it Fluffy Love.
She's trouble, they said, when she hid in the flowers and under the bed. With her big brown eyes and her funny ways, my silly Fluff's here to stay.
Fluffy Love.
Yellow Silly Fluff from the Fluffy Dogs collection. New from Kenner.
Yuck! Look at your toothbrush.
I know. My gums are bleeding. Could be gingivitis, young lady.
Well, what can I do?
Use Aquafresh. Important clinical evidence proves Aquafresh helps remove the plaque that can cause gingivitis.
Fights cavities with fluoride. Freshens breath. Helps remove plaque to reduce gingivitis in one complete toothpaste.
Aquafresh fights plaque and gingivitis.
Try Aquafresh in the new super economy size pump.
Kibbles and bits, kibbles and bits. I'm gonna get me some kibbles and bits. Kibbles and bits.
Now, baby's got his own special formula.
Kibbles and bits.
Puppy formula kibbles and bits. With hard, crunchy bits and tender, chewy bits. With protein from bits of whole grain cereal, beefy bits, and bits of egg.
I'm gonna get me more kibbles and bits.
Puppy formula kibbles and bits. Every bit better for baby.
Kibbles and bits.
The Care Bears and the Care Bear Cousins are back in an all-new adventure, Care Bears Movie 2, A New Generation. You can journey back to when the Care Bears were cubs and meet their friends Noble Heart Horse and True Heart Bear as they race to save the kingdom of caring. There's a lot of caring to share in Care Bears Movie 2, A New Generation. You can bring someone you care about. Rated G. Starts Friday, March 21st at select theaters.
We're back now on Main Street talking about sex on this sixth edition of our program.
Perhaps because giving birth is a uniquely feminine experience, we generally hear and talk more about teenage mothers than we do teenage fathers. And maybe that's as it should be, because experts tell us that most teenage fathers, after their babies are born, have very little contact with their children or their baby's unwed mother. Still, about 25% of them try hard to live up to their responsibilities. Let's meet one who's trying. He's a high school senior in Philadelphia who got help and counseling from the Teen Fathers Program at the Medical College of Pennsylvania.
Hello. My name is Brian McCullough. I'm 18 years old, and I'm a teenage father.
When I first found that I was going to be a father, I kind of felt kind of great, but I thought that I was like a little too young to be a father. I guess because I didn't have no job. I didn't think I could be responsible, because that's like a big thing to take care of as a child. It's not like no a doll baby. After you get tired, you could just throw it down. It's just like you just got to always take care of it. My daughter Danita lives with her mother Tawana. I see my daughter every day. I work at Zig's Cakes on the weekdays after school and on Saturdays.
Hi.
I was hired as a dishwasher. Then after a year, I got promoted to being a baker. Before I became a father, I never thought about, you know, having money in my pocket or whatnot. After my friend had told me that she was pregnant, then I decided that I had to get a job because my daughter couldn't live off $2 or $3 a day. To make my work go faster, I usually think about hurrying up to go to the babysitter to pick up my daughter and take her to my girlfriend's house.
Nita?
Nita.
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 You got to pay the babysitter next week.
40.
Okay, so that's $60, right?
62.
But one of the things that I share with Tawana is money. She will, like, bring her check to me, and I will have my check, and we will manage things out.
I need a haircut. Oh, boy.
Every Saturday, we would take a subway, and we would go to the shopping market. We would get Pampers and cereals and soups for our daughter. We traveled 10 miles all the way out there because the prices are very cheap. You can get sometimes two things for the price of one. Being a father changed my life because I used to run track before I had a daughter. But being so now I have a daughter, I have to work and I have to cut out my track career, which I really loved a lot. And also, I used to play a lot of basketball and hang around with my friends, and that's some of the things that I can't do no more.
I didn't know how Brian was going to be as a father, but I knew that he wouldn't let me down.
I never thought about not taking the responsibilities because my father had told me to never neglect your daughter or son, so I had came from off his answer, and I don't think I will ever do that.
There you go, bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
There you gotta go, bye-bye.
Okay. Get in.
I feel love for my daughter when I hold her because she can also hold me back and kiss me. I like myself better now than maybe 2 years ago because I feel good about taking care of my daughter. When my daughter grows up, I would like her to say I love my father just as much as I love my mother.
Having now looked at teenage mothers and fathers and done the questions and answers with Dr. Ruth, you might think that we have exhausted the subject of teenage sex. But we haven't. Perceptions being everything, we'll come back in a moment, take a step back, and see how adults look at sex and at what teens think of that view. But before all that, one last Oscar nominee. This one again from the movie White Nights. You are listening to Lionel Richie with Say You, Say Me.
Say you, say me. Say it together. Truly.
Some pine cleaners have what it takes.
more pine. Some pine cleaners don't. Pine Saw Cleaner has more pine to clean, deodorize, and disinfect for a complete clean. The latest contender? Not enough pine here to disinfect. To deliver a complete clean like Pine Sol. Pine Sol, the more complete cleaner.
Is your hair dried out from coloring or perming? Try combing your conditioner through before you rinse. Get it everywhere.
Salon Secrets from Germac. Dried out hair.
Germac's hair care experts know dry hair is thirsty for rich moisturizers. And Germac EFA shampoo and conditioner have got them. They're the key to soft, sexy hair. So go ahead, color your hair, perm it. It's okay. Just use EFA, Germac's salon secret for dried out hair. And try using extra conditioner on the ends. That's my secret.
These lonely Pound Puppies need someone to love. Someone who'd love a little puppy love.
For you, Grandma.
Pound Puppies are as cuddly as real puppies.
He'll keep you company in the dorm.
They're the perfect way to say, I love you. For birthdays, holidays, or any day. Pound Puppies, so soft and adorably lonely. Sometimes the hardest thing about giving them...
Happy Valentine's Day.
...is giving them up.
Pound Puppy, you're my one and only puppy love.
What's that?
Oatmeal. It's good for you.
Well, Ma, if you don't mind, I'd rather have my Rice Krispies.
Oh? They didn't teach you about vitamins in medical school?
Ma.
You were absent when they talked about nourishing foods like good old-fashioned oatmeal.
Mother, Kellogg's Rice Krispies is higher in iron and eight very nourishing vitamins than your oatmeal.
Well, Mr. Doctor, is that a fact?
Yes.
But if you prefer a second opinion...
Snap, crackle, pop, Rice Krispies.
Back now in the grandstand with my friends here for some final thoughts on the subject of sex. I think we can all agree that sex is a serious issue for today's teenagers, but is it treated seriously? These days, newspapers, magazines, radio, television, records, videos, they all deliver strong messages swiftly to all of us. What is the message that's being delivered to American teenagers? We've asked two teens to comment.
I'm Alvin Sams. I'm 16, and I live in Oakland, California.
I'm Providence Alvira. I'm 17 and I live in Hayward, California.
What's love got to do with it? What's love but a second-hand emotion? What's love got to do with it? Who needs a heart when a heart can be broken?
Thanks to the media, today's teenagers have learned one thing. Life is all sex.
Are you going to do it?
Sex is definitely an important teenage issue because teens have to think about it and learn to make decisions about it. But the media doesn't approach it in a very constructive way.
Are you ready for me, Ralph?
We see hot and steamy sex scenes on daytime TV.
That's fine.
Come here. I want to dry you off.
But probably the most suggestive material is on nighttime TV, where sex is equated with power and money.
When you're close up, that one close up counts.
Advertisers use sex to sell their products. Editors of teen publications print sexy pictures to sell magazines. We read that if you're a celebrity like Farrah Fawcett, Nastasha Kinski, Jessica Lange, or Jerry Hall, it's almost fashionable to have a baby out of wedlock.